Okay, we're gonna get started, and you're gonna have to help me out because my voice is gone today. Professor Colquitt asked me to provide a brief welcome to our distinguished visitor, writer and critic, and very good friend, Larry McCaffery, professor emeritus from our department. And I would just want to say a few words of thanks first to Claire and to Larry for organizing this event and making it happen. And Professor Colquitt also asked me to say just a few words about what this series is part of. This is part of an extended conversation that the department has organized for this semester that we're calling the Humanities in Action Series. It's a symposium that we began last year with the group that is pretty much right there in the back of the room, to try to showcase the research and the creative endeavors that we are doing in the department and in the humanities more generally, and also to prevent, to provide a vehicle for faculty to showcase their research. Later this semester, we'll have a visit from Ray Ryan, organized by Professor Peter Herman, who is Senior Commissioning Editor at Cambridge University Press. And then in late March, we'll have a conversation panel, I guess we're organizing it as, between Professor Philip Serrato and Professor Quentin Bailey on a shared topic called The Immigrant Other. And that takes place on March 23rd, I believe. Is that right, Philip? I'm particularly pleased to get to welcome Larry, and I'll soon turn it over to Professor Colquitt to give the formal introduction. This is a personal delight of mine because Professor McCaffery and Professor Cindy Gregory up in the front were the first people to welcome me to the department. They took me on the tour of the campus during my campus visit. They kind of reassured me. They put up with me during an epic nosebleed that I had during my visit. And generally just radiated this kind of warmth and camaraderie that made me feel very lucky to be on the campus and extremely fortunate when I took this position. So it's wonderful to see you, Cinda, wonderful to see you, Larry, and I will turn it over to Professor Claire Colquitt.
Okay, thank you, Michael. Again, I want to thank the department staff, especially Ashley Vararo and Katie Waltman, for their help, as well as David Poddick and Ari for their help from ITS for taping today's event. I'd especially like to acknowledge the attendance in the corner of the room, okay, of three of SDSU's most cherished librarians, okay, Markle Tumlin in American and British Literature, that's his area, Anna Culbertson and Amanda Lanthorne in Special Collections. And Amanda, I want to especially acknowledge because she has been working literally for months, possibly more than a year, cataloging Larry's papers. And you said your deadline, self-imposed, for creating a finding aid is sometime in summer, and all I can say is based on what I've seen of those boxes, I think it's at least 30 to 40 lineal feet. Good luck, Amanda! But Amanda has also just gotten a tenure-track job in the library, too, so this is a really nice moment for Amanda. Okay, and in addition to the papers, there are in Larry's collection a number of book objects that are fascinating, which she recently shared with my honors class, okay, and including a book with a hook and a simulacrum cake, which I really wanted to eat, okay, but thought it would be better not to. Anyway, what Amanda is doing right now is really, finally, the purpose is to allow, to create a means for researchers in the future to have access, easy access, to what is truly a literary treasure trove, thanks to Larry. We are genuinely honored to have among us Larry and Cinda, okay, both longtime and beloved members of the department who long ago discovered their shared passion for American literature, especially branches of study such as science fiction and detective fiction that were not seen as worthy of serious study for many decades. Okay. Recipients of multiple awards, not least a Fulbright grant that took them both to Beijing in 1989 in Tiananmen Square, you all fled. Okay, and of many honors for their teaching, Larry and Cinda, both Southwesterners by birth, he's from near Dallas and she's from, oh goodness, what?
Portales.
Portales, New Mexico, how could I forget? Met as students at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. The rest, as they say, is meta-history. Okay, together and singly, they are authors or editors of multiple books. Cinda's first book was Private Investigations, the novels of Dashiell Hammett. a study that reflects her continuing fascination with detective fiction and film noir. Larry's first book was The Metafictional Muse, the work of Robert Coover, Donald Barthelme, and William Gass. Over the course of Larry's and Cinda's distinguished careers, they co-edited together two books of author interviews, and Larry, either singly or with Tom LeClaire as fellow editor, completed another two books of author interviews. Larry calls his author interviews the most rewarding part of his professional career. And if anyone has looked at those interviews, and Larry has kindly brought a few of his books, okay, to our class, okay, today, you know that he gives primary place to the author's voice in those interviews. And so with that in mind, I'm going to conclude this introduction by reading something, and some of it may sound dated, but it's really not, that Larry wrote for contemporary authors some time ago. Quote, "My professional life began amidst the disruptive but liberating energies of the late 60s, a period which produced in me, and in many of the authors I admire, a healthy distrust for authority figures, be they literary or political, and for conventional modes of discourse. Much of my professional life has been involved with analyzing and teaching, and in a sense, promoting non-traditional fiction. My interest is not in experimentation per se, but in fiction which challenges our assumptions, makes us feel uncomfortable, encourages us to re-examine our lives. I admire artists who take risk. Coover, Barthelme, Pynchon, Gaddis, Calvino, and Kennedy in fiction, Coppola, Allen, Godard, and Kubrick in film, and David Byrne, Bruce Springsteen, Lou Reed, and David Bowie in popular music. The postmodern intersection of highbrow and popular culture seems to me a welcome phenomenon. I'm as passionately involved in baseball and rock music as I am in literature, and I'm interested in exploring these intersections in my writings and in my personal life. As a self-professed groupie whose biggest thrill was once shaking Mickey Mantle's hand, I have sought out writers, tried to talk with them, have drinks with them, and get to know them as people wherever possible. The result has been the most rewarding work I've ever done. With no further ado, I will give Larry the floor for a rewarding talk.
Thank you, Claire. I want to begin by thanking everybody, Claire, Michael. Yeah, and I do remember picking up Michael, who looked like he was about 15 years old at the time. I also want to apologize to Cinda and to Claire that I wasn't able to get my hair cut yesterday. Cinda's been horrified by this, but it just wasn't going to be able to happen. You know, the subject of my talk today is that portentous title, The Aesthetics of the Literary Interview. And I'm going to talk about that. I'm going to focus on that. But I thought I would use this also as an opportunity talk a little bit about my books and the way that those books reflect a kind of change, my changing attitudes about contemporary fiction and also the whole interview process. So we'll see how this goes. It's not a formal lecture. I warned Claire, I don't do that anymore, but we'll see how this goes. I also want to use this as an opportunity to promote the special collections at the San Diego State Library. I'll get into this later on, but early on, when I first started out as a teacher and as a critic, I was encouraged by some friends of mine to think of myself as an archivist. Back in the, again, I'm going to maybe talk about this in more detail in a minute, but back in the 70s, it's hard to remember that back in the 70s, postmodernism wasn't even a term yet. There wasn't a term yet that was associated with this yet. And another thing that you may not realize is the insignificant role of contemporary fiction in the academic classrooms. Not just the academic world, but also the world of classrooms. So for example, when I was an undergraduate at Notre Dame, I took the first class that was ever offered there in contemporary fiction. I mean, contemporary fiction was not considered to be worthwhile studying, you know, the idea being that you didn't want to study works that hadn't stood the test of time. So contemporary fiction was a relatively new topic for academics. And so when I went on to University of Illinois in 1968, Now, think about 1968. It was the height of the Vietnam War. We had the Martin Luther King assassination. We had the Kennedy assassination, the whole Vietnam period. And when I moved on to Illinois, I'd already decided that I wanted to focus on contemporary American literature, in particular, a kind of new kind of fiction that seemed to me to have emerged in the United States, starting in the maybe late 50s and early 60s. But by the late 60s, it was obvious that the most significant writing, fiction writing, had really broken in certain interesting ways from the traditions of realism. So the writers at that point that were well known were the 1950s writers, people like Saul Bellow and William Styron and John Updike and Philip Roth and those kinds of people. So this new wave of writing, you know, by Vonnegut and Joseph Heller and Thomas Pynchon and Robert Coover and Donald Barthelme, et cetera, et cetera, it seemed fresh and interesting and innovative in all kinds of ways. But when I got to the University of Illinois, I discovered that there was not a single, not only was not a professor interested in contemporary fiction, but there was never, and I, as far as I know, there still has never been a course taught at the University of Illinois in contemporary fiction. Now, maybe that's changed, but that was the sort of environment I was moving into. And this in a way is gonna tie into the whole literary interview issue, because there simply weren't many places that you could publish literary interviews in those days, or publish essays about contemporary fiction. In the 1970s, when I started working on my thesis and started writing about contemporary fiction, there was a couple of journals that had come up recently. There was a journal called TriQuarterly. There was a journal called Contemporary Literature. But there was only one literary journal called Critique, Studies in Modern Fiction. That was the only literary journal that specialized in contemporary American fiction. In particular, contemporary fiction by writers that were not well established. That is, in some of these other journals, you could find essays about Thomas Pynchon and John Barth, Joseph Heller, but there wasn't any academic attention being paid to people like Coover and Gass and Barthelme and all these other writers. So the environment really had changed. Has changed incredibly, maybe too much so. I remember by the 1990s, it was like the asylum members are running the institution now. It got to be to the point where that was just about all that was being taught. And I believe it or not, I didn't feel that was a good situation either. Anyway, a couple of things. I may pass these around, but I wanted to point this book out. This was my first book of interviews, Anything Can Happen. And probably this was the most important book that I ever did. I'll talk about this book a little bit later on. But I wanted mainly to point out, and you can look at this, the photo here at the back. I'll pass the book around later. This is my friend Tom LeClaire, and that's me. And if you look carefully, you can see that I'm wearing a Hawaiian shirt. So I want you to know that I was wearing Hawaiian shirts long before they became kind of trendy, if they are trendy. Maybe I'll also brag that I'm pretty sure I wasn't the first professor to teach courses wearing a t-shirt, but I'm pretty sure I was the first professor to be on an MLA panel wearing a t-shirt. So I've kind of, my sartorial influence is also enormous. Another thing I want to mention, you know, this classroom was the first, I taught my first class in contemporary fiction in this classroom in 1976. And one of the great advantages of coming to San Diego State at that time was that the department was wide open. That is, when I was hired here, I was told that I could teach graduate seminars in postmodernism my first year. And in most universities, you know, there was a whole pecking order, and you didn't get to teach your own specialty as far as a graduate seminar until, you know, 3 or 4 years in at least, or probably not until you were promoted to associate professor. So there's that. You know, and I also want to say, when I think it's worth worthwhile noting. I think Michael knows this, Claire knows this. I think San Diego State, the English department, really needs to, I know we've done this to a certain extent, but to promote what a remarkable English department we've had over the years. When I arrived at San Diego State in 1976, we had what, 54 full-time faculty members. And I would say, without a doubt, the quality of the English professors in that department, we had the best English department in California. I mean, better than UCSD, better than UCLA, better than Berkeley. We had a remarkable and remarkably diverse group of faculty members here, and many of them were, you know, major people, people like Jack Benson, who wrote the Steinbeck, authorized Steinbeck biography. I could go list. There was, we probably had a dozen major figures in English and American literature there at that time. So anyway, maybe one of these days we'll have a book or something that will celebrate all that's happened here. Okay, lastly, I want to point out in terms of the interview, this is not the first time that I've talked about the literary interview or the value of the literary interview. In fact, I've talked about this dozens of times over the years in promotions and promotions committees. That is, when I started this whole process of conducting literary interviews definitely were not considered to be serious academic work. You know, it's like, what's so hard about sitting down and turning on a tape recorder and just transcribing an interview? That's not real serious scholarship. So there were battles about this, not really quite so much with me, because I was finally got my promotion to full professor before my first book came out. But it came up repeatedly with Cinda Gregory. And in that Mississippi Review issue, and by the way, that's the most extended treatment that I've ever had as far as talking about the aesthetics of the literary interview and what makes the literary interview distinctive. But that interview and the writing I did in that really was inspired by a couple of things. One was a battle with Cinda at that point for promotion. And at that point, of course, she couldn't do that. So that was one of my jobs, was to argue that literary interviews were significant forms of scholarship, and that what was involved in doing a literary interview was something a lot more than just sitting down with a writer and turning on the tape recorder. A little bit later, this is, I think, in 1990, this is mentioned in the Mississippi Review interview with me. I went to Germany to a conference on postmodernism and the avant-garde, and that's the first time I ever actually seriously thought about the aesthetics, let's say, of the literary interview and what made a literary interview different from other forms of interviews and other forms of discourse. And it was following that Lou Scheiner and I sat down and we did this interview that's in the Mississippi Review, and I'm going to I know that the graduate students in here anyway have, you've Xeroxed this, right? They had access to this. And I also know that there's people here that don't have access to this. You can look at it online, but I'm gonna quote a couple of passages from this. But not a lot. And I'm gonna try to leave us some time for question and answer. My original idea was just to do a very quick thing and then mostly focus on question and answer. So I'm going to try and not talk too much. All right, let me get my glasses out here. How did my work as a literary interviewer come about? There's a couple of things I think I could point out. In terms of, you know, nobody's really asked me who are your influences as a literary interviewer the way you would ask a writer. But if they did ask me, I would say there was probably three. Plato, remember the dialogues, James Boswell and his famous Life of Johnson. And that was very important. I mean, I always liked the idea, I was intrigued with the idea of becoming a friend to a writer. and using that as a means to promote and get some of the spoken words of these writers out in a different format. Now keep in mind, in the 18th century, there really weren't any academic disciplines. And if a writer wanted to talk about their own work, they wrote essays, basically, or it appeared in different, autobiographical materials. But Johnson and Boswell, that relationship, that always seemed to me to be the ideal situation. You'd get to be close to a writer, friends with a writer, and sort of bask in their light. The third influence, in an odd way, was a novel, Pale Fire, by Vladimir Nabokov, which is about a critic that wants to be friends with a writer, the famous Charles Kinboat, who's completely mad, by the way, and wants to get close to a writer, but is unable to do so. And that book is significant in many ways, but it creates a kind of parody of a parasitic critic that is misreading things constantly and trying to promote this other writer's work as really being inspired by him. In other words, it's a good example of a literary interviewer that really tries to focus on himself rather than on the writer. So, I should also mention two other things. And this is the first time I've ever mentioned this. The real background of my literary interviews, though, probably comes about from my life in the fourth, fifth, and sixth grade. I was living overseas, and I was moving around, and I was in three different schools. And in three different schools, I talked so much in class to my classmates that the teachers had to remove me from the rest of the class and move me up behind the teacher's desk. So I don't remember myself being disruptive or anything, but apparently, I remember my fourth grade report card started out, talks incessantly with his neighbors, interrupting their work and his own. So I guess anyway, I think I always had the gift of gab or the Irish or the obsessive talking too much. So this was a perfect thing for me to move into, is talking with writers, maybe also being a professor. The other thing is, which is not quite so personal in a way, and I never really thought about this until relatively recently, is that when I was an undergraduate, my main interest was in theater, contemporary theater. And I had assumed that that was the area I was going to focus on in graduate school. And I also had some pretensions about becoming a playwright, which never panned out. Cindy's always telling me, you should still go back and do this. So it was only later on that I realized that in a way, my literary interviews, the interview, was a kind of a play. It was kind of like my version of a play. And in the sense that, you know, you have an introduction to the interview, which sets the stage, right, the way stage directions might. Again, I love Eugene O'Neill's elaborate stage directions. Then you had this magical moment then where out of the darkness, or out of the emptiness, two voices begin to talk. And in the course of the play or the interview, things are revealed. And again, I wasn't thinking of plays as a sort of formal, something that I was aspiring to. But I did always think from the very beginning that a good interview was like a play. I mean, I didn't think of it as a play, but in other words, a good interview should have, for example, a snappy opening, something to grab people's attention, right? And it should then develop as it goes along, and then you wind up, hopefully, at the end with something. I was always really trying to get a conclusion that would, you know, blow people away, that would sort of sum things up. So I was thinking as that kind of structure. Now, in the beginning, and now let me now go back to talking about the interviews a little bit more in particular. When I finished my graduate studies at University of Illinois, there weren't many jobs in contemporary fiction, and there weren't many other professors studying contemporary fiction. I mean, there was probably just half a dozen people at that point. And that was good, in a sense, for me starting out, because I could contact these other professors and we could correspond about stuff and we would meet at conferences and stuff like that. It was a very small club. And again, remember, we didn't have a term for this yet, even. That's how new this was. I mean, postmodernism didn't really become the settled term until the late 70s. In the mid-70s, you had metafiction. That was my term. That was the title of my thesis. You had parafictions, which was a term that James Rother, in our English department, had come up with. Then you had post-contemporary fiction. You had a whole bunch of stuff. But the point is, the field was in flux. So anyway, one of the guys that I started reading was a guy named Jerry Klinkowitz, who was a professor at the University of Northern Iowa. And he had done a book of interviews with contemporary writers that I really admired. And just at the point when I was about ready to give up, because it didn't look like I was going to be able to get a job, and what was I going to do, he sent me a kind of a fan letter, because we had both appeared in a special Donald Barthelme issue of Critique. And he sent me a letter saying that he really liked my essay on Donald Barthelme, and that was for a graduate student. I mean, you couldn't imagine what that made me feel like. And I wish Jerry was here today so I could thank him, because he really made a difference. As soon as I got that letter, I wrote him back and said, you know, nobody's listening to me, and I don't think my the people on my thesis committee hate this, and they think this is ridiculous. And he sent me, like once or twice a week, long letters. This is before the cell phone era. Basically reinforcing my sense about how significant this new work was. And I finally went up and met him a couple of times, and there was another kind of light that went on when I went up there, because both times that I went up to visit Jerry, I spent the weekend there, and the occasion was always the visitation by a writer. And there would be a public reading, a Q&A session, and then a party afterwards at Jerry's house. And boy, did I think that was cool. There I was at a party drinking beer and talking with Kurt Vonnegut or Jerzy Kosinski. Now, another thing that Jerry emphasized was he took this very seriously. I was telling Jessica that the only analogy might be the kind of feeling that I think some faculty members had about 15 or 20 years ago with the rise of electronic literature, that there was something really interesting and new and significant that was emerging. And what Jerry said basically is that we are the people, as critics, we are the people now that are responsible for conducting interviews, writing essays, writing books about this stuff, and promoting this stuff. This is the same kind of situation we were in, he was arguing, that we had back in the 1920s, when you had all those great modernist writers, you know, Hemingway, Faulkner, Sherwood Anderson, blah, 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 John Dos Passos. And he also emphasized that we should think of ourselves as archivists, that we were collecting this early stuff, and that this was going to be used for decades, hopefully, by later critics. So that made... Is that Bill?
Yeah.
Bill!
Sorry.
My man!
I'm sorry.
All right, Bill. Text next. All right. Yeah, I just remembered, Bill, I was looking at that review of contemporary fiction. I remembered your essay about Susan Deitch in there. Archivist. So what he told me, and again, it's hard to describe how new all this seemed, but he said what I needed to do was I needed to contact writers, meet writers, interview writers if that was possible, and also save all their correspondence, get them to sign all the books. You know, you needed to get all the first editions. And again, the idea was to think of what I was doing in a serious way, that you should be an archivist, because this moment, this emergence of this new kind of literature was that important. So with that, I came to San Diego State and I started working on my career, And one of the things that started happening was I started doing interviews. Now, a couple of things with that. I mentioned there weren't many places to publish interviews. The most important place and the model for this, my model was the Paris Review Literary Series. What do they call that? The Paris Review, anyway, I can't remember the name of it. But at that point, that was by far the most prestigious place to publish interviews. And if you went and looked at those interviews, they were certainly not just off-the-cuff kinds of, you know, let's turn on the tape and talk and see what comes out of that. These interviews had obviously been edited and worked on. It was a process of collaboration. So one of the guys that was teaching that was writing about contemporary fiction at that point that I contacted was a guy named Tom LeClaire, and Tom was the guy that was my co-author in this first book of interviews. And what was interesting, what I admired about Tom, he'd already, by 1977 or 78, had already published two interviews in the Paris Review series. So I remember contacting Tom, how do you do these interviews? And then pretty quickly, I had no basis for this at all. I said, hey, why don't we do a book together of interviews? And luckily he didn't say, well, you've never even published an interview. But he agreed with the big idea, and starting about 1978, we started combing America for the most significant contemporary American writers. Now, when I started doing the interviews, my sense, I would say, was very naive about what interviews were. I mean, I really did think that you just sort of showed up, and you turned on the tape recorder, and let it run. Now, in order to do that, of course, you had to prepare for the interview, right? And in a sense, I think like everything I've ever done, I over-prepared. But I mean, I don't think you can really over-prepare for an interview. But I certainly did. I read all their books. I read all the stuff. How much time did I spend in the library in the old days with microfiches and so forth, paging through these obscure literary journals and newspapers to find book reviews and the few short interviews, usually very short interviews with writers that I could locate. So then, after I got that together, then came the time to actually do the interviews and to prepare for the interviews. And the first thing I did was prepare. I was very organized in those days. I prepared an elaborate series of questions, typed questions, 20 to 25 pages of questions. And you know, another thing I used to do is I would type up quotations from the writers, from passages from their books or from interviews that I could consult. And I was kind of a control freak, you know, so I went into these interviews thinking, okay, we're gonna be in control here. We're gonna start off with this. Like, for example, I spent hours, days trying to figure out what's the first question am I gonna ask? You want to start off with something. What's gonna work? What are they gonna wanna talk about? And then I had the whole interview very careful, because I was thinking, you know, let's make these interviews organized. Let's make them feel like they have a flow, like there's a movement, that there's transitions, and that they're leading up to a moment, a high point, and then you have this pow, this conclusion. And my thinking was that we'll do it through the questions, right? We'll start off with this great question to start with, and then we'll pursue this, and then we'll da-da-da-da, and then we're gonna end with this question. Well, it didn't take very long for me to figure out that that didn't work very well. You know the famous Mike Tyson quote, everybody's got a plan until you get punched in the mouth. So, for example, the interview I did with Robert Coover, which probably was the interview I was most nervous about, because I'd written my thesis about Coover and my first book was about Coover, and he was a very tough guy to get to do an interview. One of the reasons he was tough to get to do an interview was he'd had a couple of interviews published in which he was in class, you know, coming to a class, and somebody in the back turned on the tape recorder and then transcribed the interview. And Bob was horrified that this stuff wound up getting published. He didn't get permission for that, and he didn't sound right. Anyway, so I was really prepared for this interview. And I remember going up to his office at Brown University and sitting down, and I was nervous, and I'd met him a couple times before, but anyway, I turned on the tape recorder and I came up with this beautifully phrased quote and question, and it was gonna lead into the whole first half of the interview. And Bob said, I don't think I wanna talk about any of that. So at that point, I had to improvise basically from that point on. But that was a good experience for me, because you know, doing an interview, you don't really know where it's going to go. And you want to be as prepared as you can, but you've got to be willing to go with the flow. You've got to get a sense of what writers want to talk about. And for example, if they want to talk about something that you have, you know, you had no idea that you were even going to talk about, you let them talk about it. And you improvise at that point. And you know, that leads to another thing about interviews. I'm gonna, you know, in the Mississippi Review, my friend Lou Shiner fed me a question about the relationship between duplicate bridge. I used to play duplicate bridge. Now I'm playing duplicate bridge again. But the analogy between my skills as a duplicate bridge player and as an interviewer. So that was a Fed question. You know, I asked him to ask me that question because I thought that through. So what I was driving at there is a good duplicate player, a good bridge player, a tournament bridge player. The first thing you've got to have is you've got to have skills. You've got to know the game. You've got to know how to bid, and you've got to know how to play the hand. So you've got to have that kind of technical stuff. So I would say one thing with a good interviewer, literary interviewer, and I'll come back, I haven't gotten yet to the literary interview, what makes that so different. But a good literary interviewer, the first thing you've got to do is you've got to know the material. You've all seen interviews on television, right? Not so much with Charlie Rose, but with other people, where they're sitting down in a television interview and it's obvious that the interviewer has not read their work, right? They're not familiar really with their work at all. So the first thing you've got to do is you've got to have that. But here's a problem. No matter how much you know about the material, that's not necessarily going to make you a good interviewer. And some of this has to do maybe with some kind of undefinable personality thing. But you know what I mean? I remember at University of Illinois studying, say, the Romantic poetry with the number one scholar in the world, Jack Stillinger, and he was horrible in class. And he knew the stuff better than anybody else, but he didn't know how to communicate that. And likewise with interviewers, I mean, some interviewers have an ability to express their knowledge in ways and questions that are gonna intrigue the writer. And some people are just, you know, they know the stuff, but they don't really know what to ask or how to talk to a writer. So there was that. Then I said that another thing you had to do in Duplicate Bridge was, in Duplicate Bridge, you know, you play a couple, everybody plays the same hands. So you're kind of, the same hands are being shuffled around, and you're playing two or three hands against opponents that sit down suddenly at your table. And one of the things you have to do as a bridge player is you have to size people up, right? Like, are those two blue-haired little old ladies, are they hopeless players that you can just steal from? Or are they actually hardened veterans that are really good? In other words, you have to be able to read people very quickly. And that's another thing I think that's important in interviews. As I say, in the actual interview, you're sitting there with a real person. And by the way, I'll just ramble about this if it's all right. It seemed important to me to always do my interviews live, face-to-face. Not through Skype, they didn't have Skype then, but not through the telephone and not through the mail. There was something about being in the same room with a person, with a writer, that was essential. And the reason for that, to me, seems obvious. That is, it allows for you to read the situation and follow up, ask follow-up questions. If you're doing something by mail, Nabokov famously would never do a live interview. You had to send him questions and then he would, on note cards, and then he would write up the answer and send it back. There's a certain quality to those kind of interviews, and Nabokov's interviews, like everything he ever did, was brilliant. But it didn't allow for the kind of give and take, the follow-up. So Nabokov says something, and you say, wait a minute, who the hell do you think you are? No, never say that to Nabokov. So the live person-to-person thing seemed essential. So there's another thing that's involved with interviews. I'm partly saying this because I'm assuming that some of you might someday do some of this. There's another thing. Doing the interview is incredibly nerve-wracking. Later on, I maybe talk about the importance that Senator Gregory has played in my interviews. And we did a book together, almost broke up our marriage, but one of the things she did was hold my hand before almost every one of these interviews. Because no matter how many interviews I did, when it came time to actually sit down with a writer, and particularly certain kinds of writers, like Robert Coover, who was a god to me, there's something about, you know, now you're sitting there, and it's kind of like you're under pressure in a way. You have this, in a sense, intimidating person. Did anybody see the movie The End of the Tour, about the David Foster Wallace? Oh yeah, Claire did last night. You're not familiar with that, but so there's that. You've got to be able to handle the pressure. And as I say, we have some famous anecdotes I could tell you where it's, I can't do this, Senda, I can't do this. And says, no, Larry, you're going to be fine. It always works out fine, and so forth and so on. Then there's something else. And here, if it's okay, let me just briefly quote a couple of things that I say in this Mississippi Review, because it says it more articulately than I can right now. One of the things about my interviews, and I'll just say this right now, it's maybe the most important single thing. My interviews were based on real conversations, okay? They were always live interviews. But that was just the first part of a much more extended collaborative process. And by the way, collaboration. If the writer doesn't want to talk to you seriously about big issues, you're not going to get a good interview out of it. So there's always that. How do you create a situation where the writer actually is going to be willing to sit down and seriously talk with you? But, you know, my feeling was almost from the beginning. I mean, I said at the very beginning, I thought interviews, I would just go, I would transcribe the interviews, and then I would send it off to a literary journal. But, you know, almost immediately I began to see that if I did that, these interviews would be bad. They didn't, you know, they weren't articulate enough. They were incoherent. How many times throughout, you'll ask the writer a question, and then they don't understand the question, and they give you a completely different answer. So I remember talking to Tom LeClaire early on. I said, I asked Donald Barthelme this question, but he didn't understand, so what should I do about my question? Do I have... And he basically said, forget your question. Just reinvent your question. Invent a question that invent the question that he answered, in other words. Then the other advice that Tom gave me very quickly was don't even think about doing a transcription and then sending that off. That's really just the start of the interview. You need to, he said, I remember distinctly, it's up in the special collections, he sent me a letter saying, I don't know about you, but I think the most important thing is to edit the hell out of these things. Edit the hell out of these things. So you edit and you edit and you edit, then you shuffle things around in the interview. You know, you ask a question on this topic, and then an hour later, the writer is talking about something else, but it turns out to be very relevant. So what you do is you just splice it back together with the first part of the question. So I guess part of the point is the Q&A has a kind of almost parodically mimetic implication, doesn't it? I'm asking the question, they're responding. But the reason I use the Q&A, and I think Tom, and anyway, certainly in the case of the two of us, it had to do with, it was the economy of form, right? It's a Q&A. But it wasn't, people weren't really supposed to think that this was exactly what we said. And maybe I think that created some confusion over the years, but that doesn't bother me. So, a couple of quotations here. Let me see if I can come up with them. 158. So Shiner says, by the way, Lou Shiner was one of the great young science fiction writers back in the late 90s, and he did works that were quasi science fiction, and he was part of the cyberpunk movement, but quite an interesting guy. He was in a band, interesting guy. So Shiner says, you told me you feel the interview is a genre all its own. And that's the gist of what I'm talking about today. It is its own genre, but nobody's really thought about it or talked about it. What's the basis of this claim? Isn't an interview simply a report of a conversation? And I say yes and no. Yes, in some cases, where the interviewer's aim is specifically to create a literal transcription of an actual conversation. The sort of thing you see in Playboy or Rolling Stone interviews. In some interviews, it's clear that what they've done is that they really have turned the tape on and they just transcribed that, and that's the interview. But definitely no in the case of my own interviews, where the original conversation is used more or less as a site for later improvisations and collaborations between interviewer and author. I think of my published interviews as being sort of like rap songs. This was the day in the ascendancy of rap. Because what I've done is spliced together a lot of different materials. The tapes and the transcriptions of the live interview, the various different versions of the interview that the author and I passed back and forth, bits of their letters to me, samplings from other interviews. So I didn't have any problem with just sneaking in a perfect quote from another interview, maybe slightly disguised, and putting it into my own interviews. Stealing, appropriation is the word, right? Not stealing. I mean, we are in the age of appropriation. My recollections of things they said off tape and so on. I edit and rearrange all that stuff and then reassemble this into the text that appears in the written interview. So then I say the key concept is the idea of the interview being a report or transcription. But post-structuralism has always been aware of the complexities involved whenever reality is transformed into words. And there's a basic different process going on whether this transformation is taking place in speech versus writing. Now, in case I don't bring this up here, I mean, clearly there's a difference, a kind of ontological or metaphysical difference between an interview that is presented as a live performance, right? Something you'd see on Charlie Rose. Right, where it's live like that, versus an interview that is written, that appears in a written form. And that's the key difference I'm pointing at here. Let's see here. Hang on. Oh, then I talk about the fact that the literary interviews were a recent form. You didn't really have literary interviews until really the Paris Review. There might have been a few interviews earlier on in the 20th century, but that just wasn't something that happened. You didn't have journals that specialized in that, for one thing. So one of the things I've seen now is this proliferation of literary journals focusing on contemporary fiction, so there's lots of places that this can happen. Bear with me here. I won't bore you very long with this, I hope. So Shiner says, when you're developing, I was talking about game analogies. I was talking about both bridge, but also Wittgenstein's notion of language games. You mentioned that the literary interview was a kind of live performance. So how did you mean that? And I said, I think of the actual live interview I'm conducting, interesting metaphor there, with a writer as being like two guitar players getting together and trying to do a song. Just before I get ready to meet the author, I feel like a musician must feel before going on stage. that's the biggest regret I have, is I was not in a rock band. I should have been a rock performer, but I was an athlete when I was in high school. I don't know what the hell went wrong there. Anyway, you're preparing for this. You know generally what you want to do and what you hope is going to happen. You don't want to fuck up because this is will be happening in real time. And you also know that without cooperation of the other person, the whole thing won't work. While you're doing the actual interview, which I always tape. Some writers resisted that, but that was one of the, I insisted that it had to be taped. And we have almost all these tapes. By the way, I had like a $10 tape recorder. So the quality of those tapes are probably not the best, but whatever. While you're doing the actual interview, which is taped, there's something totally artificial about what's happening. I'm talking about in terms of the discourse, in a way, what's going on between you. It's like a live performance because you're not acting or talking naturally. The situation you're in, the formality of the questions and answers, knowing that what you're saying is eventually going to appear in writing somewhere, publicly, in stone, forever, prescribes the nature of what you might mean or might, what you might or might not talk about and how you're saying it. And of course, the fact that the conversation you're having is being taped changes things as well. Just like knowing you're being photographed changes the way you look and act. Those smiles on your faces in photographs are totally artificial expressions that you never have ordinarily. The moment the tape recorders were introduced into the interview process, the form basically changed, the same way photography and motion pictures change painting and journalism. So then I go on to some other more theoretical post-structural stuff. All right, we're almost done here, getting this technical stuff out of the way. So your point is that, Steiner says, that your interviews are composed, that you're intervening in the process so that the final result is more of a composition, a written document, rather than a transcript. And I say, yes. I'm saying that in my published interviews, while they're generated from actual spoken conversations, my interviews emphasize the written quality of the discourse at the expense of the just spoken live quality. The spoken quality is still there, mind you. I always try as much as I can to recreate a sense of the author's voice and habits of speech. And after all, using the interview form at all means that I'm trying to recapture a prior experience. And the grain of the author's voice, to use Bart's notion again, is a major part of the experience I'm presenting. But the written quality of my interviews is emphasized. And in fact, when I first contact the authors, I tell them that they will have the chance to revise and rework the interviews as much as they want. Introducing those rules, of course, also winds up changing the nature of the actual live interview, because we both know our conversation is basically a rough draft. I find that relaxes us both and winds up encouraging the author to speak more freely because they know they can edit things out later. Now, let me say here, I think the key to my interviews, in a way, in addition to all the many qualities that I brought to it, was that from the beginning, I told the writers that we would not publish anything. Nothing would ever appear without their permission. And that although I would tape the interview, that I would then send them transcriptions of the interview, and that we would work on the interview, they could work on the interview, I would work on the interview, and we would send this back and forth as many times as we needed to until they were happy. Now, some people say, well, that's not, there probably are reasons to do an interview where the writer doesn't feel that way. Again, I recommend seeing the David Foster Wallace film where he's being interviewed by a Rolling Stone guy, but he doesn't have that. He doesn't have control over the interview. And Wallace hated that. He didn't like that. I had done a long interview with Wallace and he did not want to do the interview. The only reason he agreed to do it finally, after a lot of effort by my part, was the idea that if he didn't like it, we could throw it away. And he took my promise that nothing that we did would ever appear. I gave him my word. Now, it's not easy to get writers' trust like that. And certainly in my case, over the years, the fact that I did, you know, the more interviews I did, the more I could say, well, these other guys have trusted me, and so you can trust me. But keep in mind, you know, writers are people of letters, of writing. That's what they do. They're not public speakers necessarily. Some of them are teachers, some of them give lectures, but what they mostly do is they sit in a room by themselves writing. And it seemed to me in the beginning, it seems to me now, that writers, if you're gonna interview writers, that you should allow writers, you know, they're not necessarily very articulate about what they're doing. So if you ask them a question, they may come up with a, you know, something off the top of their head, but, you know, maybe that's not really what they wanted to say. And it seemed to me only fair with writers that you would give them the opportunity to, you know, revise and so forth and so on. And by the way, you know, it also meant that if I was going to bring up a delicate subject, it meant that the writers, knowing that they could edit this out, could always, they were willing to talk more. And by the way, mostly the writers didn't just edit everything out. They felt more comfortable talking. So, you know, I see I'm already over my time limit here. Let me just point out that first book, I think the most important book, I think this was important because it kind of set the table for other critics that identified who the most important contemporary writers were, in our opinion, that we were able to get. And I think we did a pretty good job in here. We interviewed just about all of the major postmodern figures, from John Barth and Barthelme and Don DeLillo and Toni Morrison and so forth and so on. We had an interview with William Gaddis that at the last minute he pulled. And by the way, yes, we did try it. We did contact Thomas Pynchon, who's never given an interview, but we never heard back from him. This book was the book that Sen and I did. This book we did in the early 80s, and the idea with this book was to look at the next generation of postmodern writers, the people that were writing in the 80s that had, in a sense, were responding to and against some of the radical innovations of the 60s. So, for example, the most famous interview in here, the most republished one, was the interview we did with Raymond Carver. Then this book here, Across the Wounded Galaxies, this is a book of interviews I did with contemporary science fiction writers. What I tried to do in this book was to interview all of the writers that were that had contributed to the evolution of the science fiction as a form. These were all, I'd say, innovative science fiction writers that were having important impact on contemporary science fiction. And I could talk about why I thought that was so significant, but I won't right now. Then this book here was a book I started. What I wanted to do here was sort of outside of the regular categories, but I wanted to talk with the most radically innovative writers that I could. Most of these were not popular writers. But I was interested in, I call it some other frequency, writers that were writing at the real margins. Mostly writers that weren't well known and that were doing very radical stuff. So, for example, there's a couple of poets in here, like Lynn Hagenian, that were writing fiction in poetic forms, though. There was David Anton at UCSD, that his shtick was doing talks. He would come before an audience, turn the tape recorder on, and use anecdotes to talk about philosophical issues or whatever. But he was basically telling stories. So anyway, there was this. There's also this, which isn't a book, but it should have been. But this is a book that Sen and I did. It's a special issue of a literary journal that we did on contemporary Japanese writers. Do we call it postmodernism? No, just new Japanese fiction. We spent 3 or 4 different extended periods in Japan, and we interviewed a bunch of people. By the way, I heard somebody was interested in Haruki Murakami. Is that person here? Yeah. You know, unfortunately, you're not going to find, the actual tape isn't there. Most of these interviews were conducted in Japanese with a translator, and so the tapes were then taken by our Japanese colleagues and translators, and they were the ones that mostly did the... Anyway, I apologize, there's not much. It would be great if you could have more material about, for example, Haruki Murakami. And then I'll mention this because this involves, in a sense, a book that never happened. My last project, so by the early 90s, I'd done four books of interviews, and I was now ready to do my fifth book, and the fifth book was going to be about the 90s writers, this next generation of writers. And that book, which I finished but never bothered to publish, because at that point you could find most of the stuff online. But this came about by my interviewing William Volman and David Foster Wallace. And sort of the underlying premise was these were young, important, talented, ambitious writers that were being called postmodernist writers, but they were coming out of completely different set of personal, political, and aesthetic influences from the early 60s and early 70s, the 60s and 70s. So at this point, it seemed to me postmodernism was no longer useful as a term. So we needed to be looking at their works. You know, it didn't make any sense to call Volman and Wallace postmodernists because although they were aware of those earlier writers, they simply didn't share much. They were reacting against them. So I did a whole bunch of interviews with people that I did, but then I, at that point, I think I was burned out. Okay. All right, I've rambled. I'm sorry I haven't given us enough time. Surely there's some questions here. Yes, ma'am.
So as I was reading, it seems like what you were trying to capture in your interviews
that was missing from like a printed memoir biography is like this marriage between the author's voice and the author and his voice,
right,
or her voice. What kind of questions did you construct in order to get that to come out?
That's a good question. I refer you back to my Mississippi Review essay, and I could have written a book on this topic in a way. A literary interview, there's a certain formula to a literary interview that even if you can't articulate it right now, I don't think I could have in the beginning, but you probably know there's certain things that all literary interviews have. If you're going to do an in-depth, extended interview, right? And for example, the issue of influences. Well, when I started out doing my interviews, I didn't really understand. You know, I was a critic, but I didn't really understand how writers wrote. And I was thinking like a critic. And I think for quite a while I was thinking like a critic. And I think over the years, you know, pretty quickly became obvious that the question of influences, you wanted to ask that question, but you didn't really just want to ask it directly, because it's kind of simplistic and frequently misleading. Now, you know, the question is important, and getting the writers to talk a little bit about writers they admired or they were reading it, but I didn't like the question of just who are your influences. And the reason influences are important, by the way, is because it provides a shorthand way to kind of create a kind of trajectory about what their interests were. So if somebody says, oh, Borges was my big influence, or Nabokov, or Garcia Marquez, or whatever, then it helped you kind of situate. But you can also see if you're a writer, you don't want to be pigeonholed that way. Likewise, I never met a writer that you could ever, and I tried not to ever do this, really, where you'd say, you're called a postmodernist, so what do you think about that? Because writers don't think of themselves as postmodernists. Raymond Carver did not think of himself as a minimalist, and so forth and so on. So, on the other hand, another thing, the autobiographical question, okay? Writers hate that. They hate that. And yet, it's relevant, right? We all know that it's relevant to a certain degree. But that was a very tricky question. And I think if you look through my interviews, you can see me trying to get some of that in there. Again, I think of this film that we saw yesterday with David Foster Wallace. You know, his book Infinite Jest was about addiction, drug addiction, and addiction to media. You can imagine David Foster Wallace didn't really want to talk about his own problems with alcohol or drugs or his own mental problems. You know, he was clinically depressed. So asking a question like, hey, was that all based on your own experiences there? He wouldn't want to talk about that. So again, a good interview is going to find a way to bring that up, but not in a way. And you can kind of get a feel for the writer. Do they want to talk about it? Some of them want to talk about it, right? But some of them, for understandable reasons, like I'll give you an example, Robert Coover, still my hero. He definitely did not want to talk about anything autobiographical. I asked him once if he'd be interested in having me write his biography. Absolutely not. That's never going to happen, he said. After he dies, maybe somebody will do it, but he doesn't want any of that out there. And you know, I respect it. I remember I'm sort of a old new classicist or new critic. That is, that the text is finally all that there is. The autobiographical stuff and all this other stuff you can bring in, I must admit, I always mistrusted that. That finally, to me, it's when you open that book and start reading, that's what the book is. And so this other stuff, it gives you insights and views, but maybe, you know, certain types of things. So all this by way of saying, I've given you three examples. You know, the influence question, the autobiographical question. Oh, another one. Never ask a writer what something means. Any writer worth a damn is going to say, well, it means just what I said. And plus, they don't think that way. Again, I'd say, you know, most writers don't think in terms of meaning. Same thing with symbols. I mean, some of them might think in terms of symbols, but most of them, that's our way, our academic way of trying to reduce works to paraphrase, right? So I never asked a writer I wanted to know what something meant, of course. There was frequently something I didn't understand, but I always tried to work that in a way where I wasn't just saying, again, that's an insult in a way. What do you mean by that? So all these by way of saying, these are things that, you know, are part of the formula of an interview, but I think a skillful literary interviewer is gonna find a way to get that in without insulting the writer in a way. Okay, other questions? Yes, ma'am.
In order to do your interviews properly, you have to connect with the author and his work. Is there one particular author that you had difficulty connecting with?
Well, there was a lot of them. I think the most... you know, the most... I'd say the one that really strikes me is Donald Barthelme. He was a writer I greatly admired. He was the subject of my first book. He was, you know, one of the great innovative writers of the 60s and 70s. And this is another one where I remembered asking him a really long, complicated question, and he gave me like a one-word reply. And that was awkward, and it was difficult because he just wasn't... he wasn't comfortable talking about his work. So. That afternoon I spent with him, I felt like I was pulling teeth, and we fiddled around with that interview quite a bit afterwards. If you go and look at it, you can see that he added a bunch of stuff. By the way, another thing about the Barthelme interview that I got to mention this. When the interview was over, you know, we had a drink. Don was quite a drinker, and so we're sitting around there having a drink, and he said, "Hey, you want to go have dinner tonight with Borges?" Now, again, I don't know if you know Borges, but that guy was a god. Certainly one of the most important writers, maybe the most single important influence on me was the experience of reading Ficiones. And anyway, so it was like, well, okay, maybe so, Don, let's... So I can't tell you how thrilled I was. And then, so I immediately got on the phone to Senda, who was up on 67th Street, and said, Senda, but... I didn't get her, though, because there was no cell phone, and the subways were out in New York that day, so she was walking downtown to meet me at 8 o'clock that night to see a special showing of Rear Window, as I recall. So she missed going out for dinner with Borges.
Larry, you promised me I could tell people I had dinner with Borges.
She's heard this story so many, she feels like she had dinner. Okay, all right. By the way, Okay, yeah, see, that's... So by the way, you're wondering, like, what did I say to Borges when I met him? So it was, boy, did I have it perfectly. I said, I'm a great admirer of your work. So that was it. Okay, any other questions? Bill.
Just real quick, that fifth book of interviews you never published, you remember SDSU Press?
Oh, well, I hadn't thought of
it. Yeah, just think about that.
Well, you know, the reason I honestly, when I finally retired, I just made a deal. I'm completely walking away, like Rambo. He's one of my heroes. But I, you know, Bill, I over the years, I did think about doing this. You know, I kind of concluded with Mark Danielewski was the last guy, and also the some of the young innovative or electronic literature people, Caitlin Fisher, by the way. Go see this, Caitlin Fisher, and go online and watch, read These Waves of Girls. I'm sure she's done stuff since then. But that was kind of where I ended. But there were several interviews in there that I never published and I felt guilty about because of
Well,
writers.
We want to end your guilt.
Well,
and we want to exploit okay. a
well,
former
Bill, I never even
contributing
thought about that.
Editor to the press and a great.
All right. Well, Bill, I'll take that under advisement.
Anyway, I wanted to ask just a real quick comment. It strikes me what you do is the interview is its own genre, but it might be a subset of documentary
yeah.
film. I mean, there's no difference between what you do and, say, Frederick Wiseman or Kirby Dick, especially if you've seen the Derrida film by Kirby Dick. It strikes me that's what you're doing. You're artfully reconstructing.
Well,
things.
See, and you know, I said the origins of my really seriously thinking about this was at this conference on the autobiography and postmodernism. So that's true. By the way, do you know who did the sound for the Derrida movie?
Yes.
Mark Danielewski.
Oh, cool.
I remember seeing the credits rolling, and I think, but is there another Mark Danielewski? But that was just typical of Mark that there he was the sound editor for that. Nobody wants to ask me who I didn't ever get to interview. I mentioned Thomas Pynchon, the writer I most regret not interviewing. I started to include him in the Alive in Writing, which included a couple of science fiction writers. But anyway, the writer I most regret not interviewing probably was Philip K. Dick. And the reason was, you know, he lived 90 miles from here, and I thought there would always be a chance to do that, but you know, he died, he was in his early 50s, so. And he represented exactly the kind of really radically experimental writer working in a despised genre that seemed to me to be one of our great contemporary writers. And that was right at that period when I was getting interested in science fiction for various reasons. Okay, we may have quite time for one more. Anything else?
I have like a really specific question.
Sure.
We are looking at your Ursula Le Guin file. I know it's from a while ago. but we were noticing there is this theme of conscious and unconscious, and it's mentioned between you and Le Guin at least 8 times. And is that something that you wove purposely into the interview as like a reflection of her writing?
So, you know, the unconscious in what sense? Like that she was trying to tap into the unconscious herself?
Well, there were specific questions where you ask her about, she says she writes things in an unconscious manner.
Right.
And you said that her writing seems very
right.
intentional.
Right, right. So, this comes up a lot. You know, I talk about writers that... you know, you're interviewing a writer and you ask him, for example, with Le Guin, you know, she was this great anthropological feminist, brilliant writer, and she was working in science fiction. She wasn't really getting any attention. Certainly her work was as significant as anybody else. There were several writers that I interviewed for that. But anyway, her work seemed so, she was such an intellect. You know, her parents, where his father was the founder of the anthropology department at Berkeley. And she brought to science fiction a lot of intellectual, not baggage, but intellectual interest that she brought to bear in her fiction. And yet, what was interesting, what I found interesting, was the fact that she claimed, and again, this is not that uncommon. Yeah, she was very conscious about a lot of things, but she worked on the basis of her unconscious. She allowed it to move. She wasn't somebody that planned out every place. You know, she wasn't, that's not the way her imagination worked. So a lot of stuff that came through, like I think she talks a lot about the left hand of darkness, that she didn't even realize stuff about the left hand of darkness. With Ginley I and is it Estevan, that guy, she didn't really realize that there was a kind of love affair. She didn't really realize what was going to happen when they got out on the ice. And only later did she realize that really what she should have done is had them have sex out there. But, you know, there again, that's something as critics that I think is very revealing with writers, is that a lot of writers, you know, the greatness of writers, a lot of it doesn't have to do with their intellect, it has to do with something that's ineffable that you can't really describe. They're working from some deeper place in their imaginations. They're unconscious. And certain writers, you know, some writers are more aware of that and tap into that, kind of consciously tap into their unconscious. And other writers, I think with Le Guin, what she was saying is, yeah, a lot of my stuff, I don't really know where it's coming from. Remember, she said the opening of the Left Hand of Darkness, she just had an image of these characters. And she didn't know where it was going to go. So anyway, you're right, though. That I think you see that in a number of different writers. I think of Paul Auster, too. So are we about ready?
I'm afraid we have to leave for another class. But
right.
Thank you.
Okay. It was really fun to be back here. Thank you.